Hi, welcome all to the online classes for statistical methods in BSc Honors Agriculture 5th semester. And today's topic is probability, basic concepts, trial, events, equally likely, mutually exclusive, independent event, additive and multiplicative laws, theoretical distributions, discrete and continuous distributions, binomial distribution properties. Before starting to this topic, I would like to complete with a little short topic which is left in the last lecture, that is variance. The square of the standard deviation is called variance. We had studied about the standard deviation. Completed the questions related to the standard deviation in the last topic or in the last lecture. For all the three types of data, that is raw data or ungrouped data, grouped data, and continuous distribution type of data. Or now, in continuation to the standard deviation, the variance. So the variance is the square of standard deviation called variance. The square of the standard deviation, basically, first you need to calculate the standard deviation. And you have to do the square of that. And the squaring of standard deviation is known as variance. Coefficient of variation. The standard deviation is an absolute measure of dispersion. It is expressed in terms of units in which the original figures are collected and stated. The standard deviation of heights of plants cannot be compared with the standard deviation of weights of the grains, as both are expressed in different units, that is heights in centimeters and weights in the kilograms. Therefore, the standard deviation must be converted into a relative measure of dispersion for the purpose of comparison. The relative measure is known as the coefficient of variation. The coefficient of variation is obtained by dividing the standard deviation by the mean in expressed in percentage. Symbolically, coefficient of variation, that is CV, is equals to standard deviation divided upon mean into 100. That is, coefficient of variation is basically given in the percentage or expressed in percentage. So keep the formula in mind that coefficient of variation is equals to SD upon mean into 100. If we want to compare the variability of two or more series, we can use coefficient of variance. The series or groups of the data for which the coefficient of variation is greater indicate that that group is more variable, less stable, less uniform, less consistent, or less homogeneous. If the coefficient of variance is less, it indicates that the group is less variable, or more stable, or more uniform, or more consistent, or more homogeneous. So this is the conclusion about the data by calculating the coefficient of variance. Example, consider the measurement on a yield and a plant height of a paddy variety. The mean and standard deviation for yield are 50 kg and 10 kg respectively. The mean and standard deviation for plant height are 55 centimeter or 55 and 5 centimeter arithmetic mean and standard deviation is 500 respectively. Here the measurement of for yield and plantar height are in different units and the variabilities can be compared only by using the coefficient of variation. For yield, the coefficient of variation is equals to 10 upon 50, that is standard deviation upon number of into 100 equals to 20%. For plant height, coefficient of variance is 5.55 into 100 is equals to 9.1%. The yield is subject to more variation than plant height. Now it's a quiz time. So on the behalf of the knowledge which we had gained through the previous lectures or the previous topics, we are able to answer the quiz or we are able to answer the questionnaires. So which measure is affected most by the presence of extreme values? Among all the four measures, that is range, standard deviation, quartile deviation, mean deviation, which is going to be affected by most by the extreme values? Standard deviation, we had studied in the merit or demerits that standard deviation is most affected by the presence of extreme values. Variance is square of range, standard deviation, quartile deviation, mean deviation. Standard deviation, obviously, we had seen the formula. So variance is the square of standard deviation. If the coefficient of variance of variety first is 30% and variety second is 25%, then variety second is more consistent because it is less. So we can that variety second is more consistent and uniform. Yes, it is true. So we can say that it is true if true and false in context to the statement. Question number four. For the set of data, 5 is given 6 times, the standard deviation value is 0. So, for calculating the standard deviation for the set of data, you do the calculation, put the values in the formula, and the final result come out to be 0, then we say that the statement is true. The absolute measure of dispersion will have the original units. So this is the merit of dispersion. The absolute measure of dispersion will have the original units. It is true. The mean deviation value of a set of data can be take even negative value. The mean deviation value of a set of data can take even negative values. No, it's false. Now, some questions are for your assignment. Define dispersion. Define coefficient of variance. What are its uses? What are the difference between absolute measure and relative measure of dispersion? How to calculate the standard deviation for raw and grouped data. So I hope that you well understand this topic, and if you find any sort of query, you can mail me and ask the queries. Now we are moving to the next topic, that is probability. and the brief review on probability I had discussed with you. We are going to deal with basic concepts. We are going to learn some definition, that is try, event. What do you mean by equally likely? What do you mean by mutually exclusive? Independent event, additive and multiplicative laws, which are associated with the probability. Theoretical distributions, discrete and continuous distribution, binomial distribution properties. Okay, now let's start. Probability, according to the layman definition, that is chance of occurrence, okay, or happening of the event, is known as the probability. The concept of probability is difficult to define in precise terms. In ordinary language, the word probable means likely or chance. Generally, the word probability is used to denote the happening of certain event, and the likelihood of the occurrence of that event based on past experience. By looking at the clear sky, one will say that there will not be any rain today. On the other hand, by looking at the cloudy sky or overcast sky, one will say that there will be rain today. In the earlier sentence, we aim that there will not be rain, and in the later, we expect rain. On the other hand, a mathematician says that the probability of rain is zero in the worst case, and the probability of the rain is one in the second case. In between zero and one, there are fractions denoting the chance of the event occurring. In ordinary language, the word probability means uncertainty about happenings. In mathematics and statistics, a numerical measure of uncertainty is provided by the important branch of statistics called theory of probability. Thus, we can say that the theory of probability describes certainty by 1 and impossibility by 0, and uncertainty is by the coefficient which lies between 0 and 1. Okay, so we know that there are two conditions. One is certainty and second is impossibility. One can be done or one is very sure. So we just mark it one or yes or on. And the second condition is impossibility or chances next or equal to zero. And uncertainty is the values or the coefficient which lies between 0 and 1. So the uncertainty is basically defined the probability. Okay. Now come to some definitions which are related to the probability. Trial and event, an experiment which, though repeated under essential identical or same condition, does not give unique result but may result in any one of the several possible outcomes. Performing an experiment is known as trial, and the outcomes of that experiments are known as events. So trial and events are the important parameter for finding out the probability of any event or occurrence. Okay. Take one example, seed germination. Either germinates or does not germinate are event. So, we know the two condition. Either the seed will going to germinate or either it will not going to germinate. So there are two outcomes or two events. In a lot of five seeds, none may germinate. One or two or three or four or all five may germinate. If I'm talking about the seed, five seeds, then there is a chance that no one will be germinate, or either one, two, three, or four, or all five may be germinate. So sample space, a set of all possible outcomes from an experiment is called sample space. So set of all possible outcomes from an experiment is called sample space. That is all total chances. Out of all possible outcomes is called sample space. For example, a set of five seeds are shown in a plot, none may germinate, or all five may germinate. That is, the possible outcomes are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The set of numbers is called a sample space. Each possible outcome or element in the sample space is called sample point. So these are the some definitions which are related to the probability. You could better understand by taking some examples. There we are going to use these definitions as a representation. Now, exhaustive events. The total number of possible outcomes in any trial is known as exhaustive event or exhaustive cases. For example, when pesticide is applied, a pest may survive or die. There are two exhaustive cases, namely survival or death. In throwing a die or the dice, there are six exhaustive cases, since any one of the six faces, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, may come uppermost. In drawing two cards from a pack of cards, that is, I'm talking about the playing cards. And we know that a deck of card or a pack of card contain 52 cards. In drawing two cards from a pack, the exhaustive case number of ways or the number of cases is 52C2. Since two cards can be drawn out of 52 cards in 52C2 ways. So two cards can be drawn by applying permutation and combination formula. And I hope that you had a good knowledge of permutation and combination, because before starting the probability, you are most very well strong in the permutation and combination. Because all the basic concept of permutation and combinations are used in finding out the probability of events. Now the next terminology is favorable events. The number of cases favorable to an event in a trial is the number of outcomes which entail the happening of the event. Which entail the happening of the event. Example, when a seed is shown, if we observe non-germination of seed, it is a favorable event. If we are interested in germination of the seed, then germination is the favorable event. Now, mutually exclusive events. I had already discussed some definition prior to start this lecture, that is related to the probability, events are said to be mutually exclusive or incompatible if the happening of any one of these events excludes or precludes the happening of all others. That is, if no two or more of the events can happen simultaneously in the same trial, the joint occurrence is not possible. So, joint occurrence is not possible means mutually exclusive. Example, in observation of seed germination, the seed may either germinate or it will not germinate. Germination and non-germinations are mutually exclusive events. Equally likely events. Outcomes of a trial are said to be equally likely if taking into consideration all the relative or relevant evidences, there is no reason to expect one in preference to the other. That is, two or more events are said to be equally likely if each one of them has an equal chance of occurring. Independent events. Several events are said to be independent if the happening of event is not affected by the happening of one or more events. For example, when two seeds are shown in a pot, one seed germinates, it would not affect the germination or non-germination of the second seed. One event does not affect the other event. So, it is clear that these are the independent event. That means by the presence of one, the second is not affected, and by the presence of second, one is not affected. So this is known as the independent events. Dependent events. If the happening of one event is affected by the happening of one or more events, then the events are called dependent events. For example, if we draw a card from a pack of well-shuffled cards, if the first card drawn is not replaced, then the second drawn is dependent on the first draw. Obviously, if you are not going to replace or you had not put back the first card which you had drawn, and you are going to draw the second card, then the occurrence of first card drawn will automatically affect the second draw. In case of independent or dependent event, the joint occurrence is possible. So, the point must be noted that in case of independent or dependent event, the joint occurrence is possible. Now, the mathematical definition of probability. Mathematical, classical, or priori probability, if an experiment results in n exhaustive cases which are mutually exclusive and equally likely cases out of which m events are favorable to the happening of the event A, then the probability P of happening of A is given by favorable number of cases upon exhaustive number of cases is equals to M by N. So the possible outcomes upon the total outcomes. Okay. This is known as the definition of probability, mathematical probability definition. Now note some points which are related to the probability. If m is equals to 0, that is according to the formula, if m is equals to 0, then probability of an event is equals to 0, then is called impossible event. That is also by P5 is equals to 0. If m is equals to n, that is the total outcome and the possible outcome come out to be 1, then the probability is equals to 1. And we can say the 100% or called the assure or certain event. So it is of maximum chance of occurrence and it is equal to 100% if the output and the total events are same. The probability is non-negative real number and cannot exceed unity. So this is a very important point. Probability is not equal to or cannot exceed to the unity. Any that means I want to say that or I that mean that 100 before beyond to the 100% there is no probability and it is non-negative real number. That means it lying between 0 to 1. So the probability is always lying 0 to 1. If it is beyond 1, then you cannot say it is a probability or non-negative real numbers are not counted or not included, not showing the probability. The probability of not happening of an event, it is divided by Q. So P A bar is equals to N minus M upon N equals to 1 minus M by N equals to 1 minus P. So Q equals to 1 minus P or P plus 1, P plus Q equals to 1. Or P A plus P A bar is equals to 1. Now example based on probability, two dice are tossed. What is the probability of getting some 6 and some 9? So two dice are tossed simultaneously. So what are the possible outcomes? What are the possible outcomes when two dice are tossed? So the exhaustive number of cases is 36. 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4. On one dice, 1 is appearing and on another dice, 1 is appearing. So this is one case. On one dice, it is 1 and on another dice, it is 2. On one dice, it is 1 and another dice, 3. One dice, 1, 4 and 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4, 1-5, 1-5 and 1-6. Similarly, 2-1, 2-2, 2-3, 2-4, 2-5, 2-6. Similarly, 3-1, 3-2, 3-3, 3-4, 3-5, 3-6. Similarly, 4-1, 4-2, 4-3, 4-4, 4-5, 4-6. Similarly, so till 2, 6-6. So we can say the exhaustive number of total cases or the total cases are 36 when two dice are tossed. Okay. So what is the probability to get the sum of 6? So among all the exhaustive number of cases, that is 36 exhaustive cases are there, choose the numbers which make the sum 6. 1, 5, 1 plus 5, 6. 2, 4, 2 plus 4, 6. 3, plus 3, 3, 3 plus 3, 6. 4, 2, 4 plus 2, 6. And 5 plus 1, 6. So the favorable number of cases for getting the sum 6 is 5. So the probability is favorable upon exhaustive number of cases. So 5 upon 36. So this is the probability. Now, to get the sum 9. For getting the sum 9, when both the dice are tossed simultaneously, the favorable number of cases are 4. Which is shown in the slide 3,6, 4,5, 5,4, 6,3. So the probability to get the sum 9 is 4 by 36, that is favorable upon total number of cases or exhaustive number of cases. 4 by 36 is come out to be 1 by 9. So when we finally conclude to the final result, we find that the value lies between 0 and 1. So neither the probability go beyond 2 to the 1 and non-negative number. Okay. Next example. A card is drawn from a pack of card. That is playing card. I'm talking about the playing card. What is probability of getting a king, a spade, a red card, a numbered card? That means for finding out the probability in case of playing cards, you must have a sound knowledge of playing cards, that how many cards are there in a deck, how many types of card there are in the deck. There are four types of card: spade, diamond, heart, and one more type of card, I forget the name. And each type of card there are two type of color coding. One is red colored and second is black colored. So 13 card out of 52 cards are 26 card are black in color, and 26 cards are red in color. Okay. And if you go to the detailed analysis of deck of card, there are four kings, four queens, four aces, four jacks. Okay. So the question is that if you are drawing a card from a pack of cards, what is the probability of getting a king? What is the probability of getting a king? So to getting a probability of getting a king, we know that there are four kings in a card. There are 52 cards in a pack. One can be selected in 52C1. That is, one card can be selected into this combination. So exhaustive number of cases is equals to 52. Now total number of cases are 52. Now to get a king, there are four kings in a pack. One king can be selected in 4C1 ways. So favorable number of cases is 4. So hence the probability of getting the king is 4/52 or 1/14. Okay. Now, what is the probability of getting a spade? There are 13 spades in a pack. So 13 spades are the favorable cases, and the total number of cards or events are 52. Hence the probability of getting a spade is 13/52. Okay. Which is come out to be 1/4. A red card. So in a deck of card, we know that there are 26 red colored card in a pack. One red card can be selected in 26C1, that is 26 ways. So the favorable cases are 26, and the probability of getting a red card is 26/52, that is 1/2. Okay. Now, a numbered card. So, when you observe the deck of cards, you find that only 36 cards are there in which the numbers are mentioned. Okay. Starting from 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9, 10. So there are 36 numbered cards in a pack. So the favorable cases for probability of finding the numbered card, or the favorable cases, are 36, and the total number of events or total number of cards are 52. So 36/52 is the probability to get a numbered card. What is the probability getting 53 Sundays in a when a leap year selected random? So first of all, you know what do you mean by the leap year. Leap year is the year which consists of 363 days instead of 365 days. This has 52 full weeks and 2 days remain. The remaining 2 days have the following two possibilities: Sunday, Monday, Monday, Tuesday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Thursday, Friday, Friday, Saturday, Saturday, Sunday. In order that a leap year selected at random should contain 53 Sundays, one of the two over 2 days must be Sunday. Exhaustive number of cases is 7. Favorable number of cases is 2. The required probability is equals to 2 by 7. Now, conditional probability. Two events A and B are said to be dependent when B can occur only when A is known to have occurred, or vice versa. The probability attached to such events is called the conditional probability and is denoted by P A by B, read as A P A or given by B, or in other words, probability of A given that B has occurred. P A by B equals to P A intersection B upon P B, P A B upon P B. If two events A B are dependent, then the conditional probability P A B B by A P A intersection B by P A equals to P A B upon P A. So thank you. Thank you all for today's lecture. Now in the next lecture, we are going to further continuing the probability with some more examples and some questionnaires. And further, in the next lectures, we are going to study with correlation and regression. Thank you. Now, conditional probability. Conditional probability is depending upon the condition, whether the events are dependent, independent, exclusive, mutually exclusive. So, two events A and B are said to be dependent when B can occur only when A is known to have occurred, or vice versa. So, by the dependency, we already knew that the dependency, that is, one event is depending on the other. If another event is going to happen, then the first event is going to occur. Or if first event is going to occur, then the another event is going to happen. Or vice versa. The probability attached to such an event is called the conditional probability and is denoted by P A / B. Read it as A given B. Or in other words, probability of a given that B has occurred. That means it is a condition. The probability of A when the B has occurred. So P A given by B is equals to P A intersection B upon P B equals to P B A B upon P B. If two events A and B are dependent, then the conditional probability of B given A is P B by A is equals to P A intersection B upon P A equals to P A B or P A. It can be also written as P A B or P intersection B. So, this is the condition for the conditional probability. Theorems of probability. Now, the theorems of probability. There are two important theorems of probability, namely, the addition theorem of probability, the multiplication theorem on probability. First, the addition theorem on probability. Let A and B be any two events which are not mutually exclusive, either A or B. That means here the or defines the addition sign, and it can be written as probability A union B. It can be written as P A plus B equals to P A plus P B minus P A intersection B. So this is the addition theorem on probability, or it may be written as PA plus PB minus PAB. So keep in the mind, the addition theorem, when the events are not mutually exclusive. Proof. This is the proof. Let us take a random experiment with a sample space S of n sample points. So this is the sample space S having n sample points. Then by the definition of probability, P A union B is equals to n A union B upon n, or broadly can be written as n A union B upon n. So I'm just defining the proof for additive theorem. From the diagram, using the axiom of for the mutually exclusive events, we write P A union B can be written as N A plus N A bar intersection B upon N. Now adding and subtracting N A union B or A intersection B in the numerator, we get N A plus N A bar intersection B plus N A intersection B minus N A intersection B upon N is equals to, when further simplified or further simplification give, N A plus N B minus N A intersection B upon N, which can be further written as N A by N plus N B by N minus N A intersection by A intersection B by N. And finally, it can be written as PA union B is equals to PA plus PB minus PA intersection B. So when you are observing this Venn diagram, we need to calculate PA union B from this. And this is the proof for getting out the PA union B formula. Now, let A and B be two events which are mutually exclusive. That is, they are not interrelated to each other, but they are exist in the sample space. P A or B equals to P A union B equals to P A plus B equals to P A plus P B. We know that N A union B can be written as N A plus N B. So P A union B can be written as N A union B upon N, and N A plus N B upon N, N A by N plus N B by N. So we can say that P A union B is equals to P A plus P B. That is the probability of A plus probability of B. Now, note, in the case of events not mutually exclusive, events PA or PB or C. If I'm talking about the three events which are not mutually exclusive, then we can written as or write as PA union B union C is equals to PA plus B plus C, or can be written as PA plus PB plus PB plus PC minus PA intersection B minus PB intersection C minus PA intersection C plus PA intersection B minus B intersection C. Not mutually exclusive events. But if they are mutually exclusive, then we can written as, or we can write as, PA union B union C is equals to PA plus B plus C is equals to PA plus PB plus PC. Finally, okay? So, the events are more broadly classified as mutually exclusive and not mutually exclusive. Okay. Example, using the additive law of probability, we can find the probability that in one roll of a die, we will obtain either one spot or a six spot. The probability of obtaining both a one spot with a six spot is zero. there is a no side on the die that has both these events. So substituting these values into the equation gives the following result: 1 by 6 plus 1 by 6 minus 0. This come out to be 2 by 6, this come out to be 1 by 3, and the final, the probability come out to be 0.3333. Now, multiplication theorem on probability. If A and B be any two events which are not independent, that is dependent. That we can say that A and B are two events which are dependent to each other. P, A and B. Here, instead of word or, we are using the word and. So, A and B is equals to given by P, A intersection B equals to P, A, B equals to P, A dot or multiplied P, B by A equals to P, B into P, A by B. The first equation is the second equation, where P, B by A and P, A by B are the conditional probability of B given A and A given B respectively. So the multiplication theorem basically defined that the two events which are dependent to each other. So in the case of dependent events, we had seen that we can write probability of occurrence of B when A is happen, or probability of occurrence of A when B is happen. Proof: let N in the total number of events. Let NA be the number of events in A, N be the number of events in B, and A intersection B is the number of events in A union B, and A intersection B is the number of events in A intersection B. This is the proof. Have a look on the proof, and finally you got two equations, first and second. In the case of three events which are dependent, we can write the probability formula like this. Now the questionary time, probability expresses all the above. Probability can take values from 0 to 1. We had already discussed that the range of the probability lies between 0 and 1. The probability of sure event is 1, true. If A and B are the mutually exclusive event, then P, A union B, which had we had seen the formula in the last slide. An integer is chosen from 1 to 20, the probability that number is divisible by 4. So choose a number from 1 to 20 and which can be divisible by 4. So find out the total number and the possible outcome, and this come out to be 1 by 4. The statement is true. Mean of the binomial distribution is NPQ. This is false statement. Now these are the some assignment question. Define an independent event. What is conditional probability? State the addition and multiplicative laws. State the probability properties of binomial distribution. Thank you. Thank you all.